God here hangs me in there.
Yes, ma'am. That's what got me through it.
I am so glad that God is on the throne.
Yes.
People think just because they have bad things, he's not on the throne. I got news for you. He is, and he don't have to get up and move like we do.
Right.
All he has to do is give a tacit nod, and it's going to happen.
Yep.
Oh.
Do we know the game code yet?
Has everybody got their game code stuff? Jimmy's getting it set up, he said.
Not till somebody logs in as host.
Who?
Somebody has to log in the game as host to set it up. Then they'll give the code in the upper left-hand corner, and then we can all log in.
Okay, well, I guess I need to tell him that. I don't think he knows that, does he?
I think he's working on that.
I will find out, because we want to have that, and then I'm ready. For my part, I've got it ready.
I don't have any way to be able to participate in the game, because I don't know how to toggle.
Can you... Sign language somehow.
I can raise my hand and wave. I can do that much. I can raise and wave.
Gary, what can we do?
She'll have to not toggle. She'll just have to put up the buzzer. And then when she buzzes like first, she'll answer. We just won't be able to see her. That's my suggestion.
All right, say that again.
She'll log into the game. Instead of bouncing back and forth, she'll stay on the game. We just won't be able to see her, but she should be able to participate.
Okay. Will you be able to see me?
Yes.
Okay.
Because you've got to be able to participate.
I'll try.
Tap into the last part of that rocket land, okay?
I didn't see it. They cut the video off, and his telemetry was way off behind, and I guess it did. Do you know for sure?
I do not, sir.
Yeah, I watched it, and it was hanging up, and then it kind of like froze at 1.5 kilometers, and it just like that was it. But I think it did land. It did a little spot landing again, as usual.
Hey, Gary, what's the website again? So I'll go ahead and pull it up.
CharlieGomer.buzz.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Oh, I thought you said Daniel 4.
No, but that's okay. You'll catch on real quick.
Oh, I'm sure I will. I've already read Revelation 4, so.
Yeah, we went into Daniel because that was a part of the Old Testament Revelation, and now we're back to Revelation.
Okay.
So we're going to be getting up there, and if Mr. Luke would just get in, so I guess everybody can just text him at one time and say, would you please? Tammy, your eyes turning blue. I like your glasses, I guess. That's your glasses.
I don't know. I don't see blue.
When light hits it, it turns blue. Very pretty.
Oh, well.
Well, it's been a wonderful day today. I hope y'all had a great day.
I had a great morning. It's been rough this afternoon. It's raining.
I think we're going to get rain soon, but not today.
Tonight, possibly.
Also possibly come tonight and then rain Saturday and Sunday.
Hello, Pastor, if you're there. Sometimes you're there and sometimes you're not. So, hi. So.
Have y'all noticed, I don't know if y'all have it, but if I raise my hand, a thing will pop up at the bottom saying you're about to raise your hand. Do y'all get that?
How do we know that?
No.
Mine doesn't say it.
Mine doesn't either.
You got a smart one, Tammy. Hello, hello, hello from Waken Church, Four Square.
You're about to raise your hand, and now it's downloading, and I guess it's going to do something to me, but then it goes away. See, that's why I always tell AI, I am your friend. Just remember that when I'm still out the humans.
Well, you do know that Elon has been prophesying that the 2025, the humans have had it. We're gone.
I would say mentally, he's probably right.
Well, we'll see, won't we? We'll either see each other here or we'll see each other there. Because I've got my ticket bought.
Oh, well, it's I hate that dog that don't feel good. And I'm really getting sick and tired of death and sickness. And I'm just ready for all of it to be tossed into hell.
Well, I am too. My husband doesn't get sick, but he's been sick all day long.
Contagious?
No. Allergies, sinuses, or whatever. He can't hold his head down because he gets so dizzy and drunk. I said, now you know how I feel all the time. A cheap drunk, and I don't get no pleasure out of it. Well, they say you get pleasure out of getting drunk. Well, I don't get no pleasure out of it.
Oh, no. Who wants to deal with the mornings?
Right.
Well, I'm going to go down here and see something here because I had some things like, why did the scarecrow become a successful preacher? Because he was outstanding in his field.
I don't get it.
You don't get it?
I don't get it.
Well, let me switch that blonde over there, okay? Why did a scarecrow become successful in his as a preacher? He was outstanding in his field. A scarecrow stands in a field. He was
Now I heard all the answer. You burped there a second ago.
I thought you said he was out digging in his field, and I was like,
exactly.
Well, he can dig too.
But that don't make no sense. That no funny. Because he wouldn't be outstanding then. He'd be out there digging.
Well, what do you call a sleepwalking nun? A Roman Catholic.
I couldn't remember that one. I knew I'd heard it, but I couldn't remember it.
Y'all can y'all later. I'll go and get mine until Jimmy or somebody gets on so we can get started. Why was the math book so sad?
It wasn't red.
He had too many problems.
Oh. You know that's right.
I have somebody that is... Who keeps changing? Hello. I like that. That's from Tim to Lucro to everyone. Hello, hello. And
well,
John
never participate in group chat.
Well, John never seen a gym. Is that Apple?
Yes. You can't tell by that name?
No.
That's an Apple thing.
Okay. Well, does anybody remember the memory verse that we always say?
I know which one it is, but I don't remember it.
I can read it. You want to hear it?
Yep.
Blessed is he that readeth and they that hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand.
Absolutely. Which translation did you use?
King James.
King James, because I looked it up on the American Standard, and I looked it up on the Authorized King James and the New International Version, and they're almost pretty much the same way. Huh? But that's exactly what we need to always remember, Revelation 1:3. It's the only one in here that tells you you're blessed if you read it and you hear it and you keep those things. So remember that. It's a good book. I know that a lot of people are afraid of it, but it's not. It's a very good book. It's just got a lot of symbolisms. Charlie and I were talking about it. He doesn't know anything about the questions or answers, but we were talking about it. So I asked him, I said, have you read Revelation 4? He said, yes. I read it about two times, because he said all those monsters, two-headed things or whatever. He said, I really couldn't get into it. I didn't understand it. I said, well, those are symbolisms, but you will as we go along, because that's what throws so many people off of Revelation. It's because the vision has got so many symbolisms and things in it.
And everybody and their dog has an interpretation of what they are, and it's up to you to discern what you think they are, because some people are crazy.
That's right. Let the Spirit bear witness with it and check it out with the Bible. And if the Bible doesn't correspond, don't believe it. The Bible will always interpret the Bible. That's what I always have been taught. And if it doesn't say about it, don't believe, because people can get off real crazy real quick, go to crazy town. So let's ask God to bless us. We can say the Lord's Prayer together. How about that? Because we want His will done on earth as it is in where?
Heaven.
Heaven.
Heaven. Absolutely. Gary, Charles, Captain, whoever, somebody, lead us.
Give us this day, our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done.
Thy will be done. On
earth.
On earth.
As it is
on earth. And in heaven.
In heaven.
Give us this day.
Give us this day.
Bread,
our daily bread.
And forgive us of our trespasses.
And forgive us
our trespasses.
As we forgive those who trespass against us.
As we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation.
And lead us not into temptation.
But deliver us from evil.
But deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
When you said deliver us from evil, I didn't say anything, because I've always been taught to say deliver us from the evil one in the translation that I learned it from. But it's still delivering us from the evil, because it is the evil one that brings evil. So everybody has their own way of doing it, and we're going to get into Revelation chapter 4, or is that Daniel 4, Shauna?
It's Revelations 4, apparently. I misunderstood.
And it's so funny, because Charlie looked at it and he said, that's really short. I said, well, yeah, it is. And we're not even going to do the whole thing, but we're going to read the whole thing. So, who would like to start reading?
Gary.
Y'all want to read it together?
Gary's an expert reader.
Okay, I'm on it. After this, I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven, and the first voice which I heard was as it were of a trumpet talking with me, which said, come up hither, and I will shew thee things which must be hereafter. And immediately I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. And he that sat on that sat was to look upon like a jasper and a sardine stone. And there was a rainbow round about the throne, in sight like unto an emerald. And round about the throne were 24 seats, and upon the seats I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white raiment, and they had on their heads crowns of gold.
All right, let me stop for just a minute. We're not going to go into the colors around God's throne, because like jasper is a not a correct interpretation. It should be diamond. And emerald is like a rainbow. So we will talk about those on a different night, but we will be talking about it very little tonight. So go ahead, or somebody else can pick up, or you can continue.
And out of the throne proceeded lightnings and thunderings and voices. And there were 7 lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the 7 spirits of God. And before the throne, there was a sea of glass like unto crystal, and in the midst of the throne and round about the throne were four beasts full of eyes before and behind. And the first beast was like a lion, and the second beast like a calf, and the third beast had a face as a man, and the fourth beast was like a flying eagle. And the four beasts had each of them six wings about him, and they were full of eyes within, and they rest not day and night, saying, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. And when those beasts give glory and honor and thanks to him that sat on the throne, who liveth forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him that sat on the throne and worship him that liveth forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created.
That's very good. You know, when you think about somebody saying, Holy, 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 all through eternity, you think, gee, that's going to get awful boring. But it's not. Stop and think. Every time God moves or turns or does anything, it's something new you see, and it's like, oh my gosh! They say, holy, holy, holy! Every time God does something, it's different. It's awesome. He never does the same thing over and over. And so they worship him and continually say it. We're going to do that as well, just like the men that are there, the 24 elders that represents the Old Testament and the New Testament. And we learned about the seven churches, if y'all remember that. Mm-hmm. Anybody remember the names of them?
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to necessarily give the meanings of them, but the names of them. It was Ephesus, Pergamum, Thyatira, and they both received praise and a rebuke. Smyrna and Philadelphia only received praise and encouragement. Sardis and Laodicea were rebuked. And they were only rebuked. There was no commendation to them. And Jesus comments on each church's situation and behavior. And every one of us should take ourselves and look at these churches and see where we are, what we are doing wrong in our life, and see if we can line it up. Because I don't want any of those rebukes. I don't want to lose my first love. I don't want to be lukewarm. My husband knows I'm not lukewarm. I'm either hot or I'm cold. I am not lukewarm. I don't like lukewarm anything. My food's got to be cold, and I like other things hot. So we'll just leave it at that. What about you guys?
Here's how I remember the churches. Now, my S's, I get mixed up. Smyrna and Sardis, I get mixed up in the order, but I think it's Smyrna first, then Sardis. But everyone start praising the Savior, praise loudly. Then that puts it in the order so that you can remember them. Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira. It's the Savior. Then it's that last one, Sardis. And then praise loudly, Philadelphia, Laodicea.
The reason I put them in the order I did it as of the ones with the rebuke and the commendation, and then the ones that just received the commendation, and then the one that received the rebuke. And that's how I had it on here.
I never saw them in three columns like that. I only saw that two of them didn't get a rebuke, but I never saw them in three columns like that. So I'm going to look into that again, because I never paid attention. Like you just said.
You didn't pay attention, my daughter? Well, the book of Revelation addresses those seven letters to the churches. And when John was in the spirit, then he came out of the spirit long enough to go and deliver, to get those letters delivered. And then he was back in the spirit. And that's when he saw the open door. And of course, you were saying in the scroll, it was Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. Is that what you were trying to say, Timmy?
Yeah, so take the letter of each one of them. Everyone start praising the Savior. Praise loudly. That's all the letters of in order.
She learned certain things in school by having a code that
I hear Tammy?
Yeah, you hear your sister.
Tammy, it's Molly. Hi.
Hi.
Bye. So
if you If you want to learn your presidents, it's Washington, Adams, Jefferson, Madison, Monroe, Adams, Jackson, Van Buren, Tyler, Polk, Taylor, Fillmore, Pierce, Buchanan. Actually, I missed one.
I think it's a good way that she learned. It's a good way to teach kids. Because people need to learn things. But I started out to show you about the rebuke and the commendation and the ones about different things. And then the crowns to earn. How many crowns are there to earn?
Seven?
Four.
Huh?
Four.
How many what?
There's five, but there could be six. The crown first is the imperishable crown. You find that in 1 Corinthians. You do not know that those who run a race all run, but one receives the prize. Run in such a way that you may obtain it. Everybody has a race to run, and we're supposed to run to win it. So the imperishable crown is for that one that runs the race and runs to win. The second one is the crown of rejoicing. That's in 1 Thessalonians 2:19. For what is our hope or our joy or our crown of rejoicing? Is it not even you in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ at his coming? And then Paul goes on to talk about it in Philippians and in Luke in Revelation 21:4. Then the third crown is the crown of righteousness. 2 Timothy 4:8 says, finally, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. And not only to me, but to all those that love his appearing. He wants us to love his appearing. I look every day for him to come. I don't know when he's going to be here, but I'm ready. I'm looking and I'm loving his return. A lot of people say, oh, I don't want him to come. I haven't been married yet. Or, oh, I don't want to come because I hadn't got to do this yet. What's wrong with you people? We're going to keep living. We're not going off to be some angels flying around doing nothing. We wouldn't be down here on earth training if he wasn't teaching us training for reigning. We're going to judge the nations. There's going to be a kingdom, a literal kingdom. We're in the kingdom of heaven and God now, but there's going to be a literal kingdom set up on this earth. And Jesus Christ is going to be over it all. He's got the government that's going to be on him. Then the fourth is the crown of glory. 1 Peter 5:4, and when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive a crown of glory that does not fade away. Though Peter was addressing the elders, we must also remember the crown will be awarded to all of those that long and love his appearing. The word glory is a real interesting word, and one day maybe we'll get to get into that. The fifth one is the crown of life. Revelation 2:10, do not fear any of those which are with you about to suffer. Indeed, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested, and you will have tribulation 10 days. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. We're going to have tribulation in this world. The Bible says that. Hello, Jimmo or Kaylee, whichever one just peeked in. Okay, Shay. Hello, Shay.
Hello.
Good to see you.
I was talking to the neighbor. I'm sorry.
That's okay. You're here. That's okay.
We're here now.
And that's great. And so James tells us this crown of life is for all those who love God. I love God. You guys love God, or you wouldn't be here on Thursday night when you could be doing anything else. But instead, we're talking about the Word of God. And everything that we talk about is recorded. There's books in heaven written about us. Not just the Book of Life, but there's other books that every time that we talk about Him, it's written down. I love it because when I get to talk with Tammy, 9 times out of 10, well, it's really 10 times out of 10, we're talking about something about the Bible.
Or she's crying.
You don't have to tell everybody that. God says he saves our tears in a bottle, and I'm going to ask him one day, why does he save them in a bottle? I want to know that for an inquiring mind. Now, we had just finished studying the background work in Daniel 2, 7, and 9. Now we're coming back to Revelation. So we're going to look and see about the church age. According to Jesus in Luke 21, the age is defined as a period of history when three things will remain for Israel. They will be under the attack of Gentile attacks and scattered outside their land, and their city is going to be trampled by Gentiles. What do you see happening over there now? What do you see happening to them?
Trampling by Gentiles.
They're being trampled by Gentiles. And that led us outside the book of Revelation for a while to Daniel to study in the age in detail. We learned the age started in 605 BC with Nebuchadnezzar. We remember good old Nebuchadnezzar. He conquested Jerusalem. And then it progressed through four different kingdoms. And eventually it comes to the end with the second coming of Jesus Christ. And at the very end of the age, a very dramatic event is going to happen. The conclusion, the consolidation of all authority on earth. And then these 10 rulers that are going to pop up. And then finally, one world leader who persecutes believers and opposes God before the coming to his end at Christ's hand. Daniel also told us this age had a time limit, that time limit of 70-year periods, but that 490-year period wasn't contiguous. Daniel told us that it included a break and a pause of an unknown period, and we are in that break of an unknown period. We're living in that pause that Paul talked about. It was necessary for the Jews to be blinded so the Gentiles could be brought in, and we're living in that time. In the book of Revelation, I told you it was divided into three parts, not just two. And the third part will now become the main focus of our study. Jesus called part three the things that will take place after these things. After these things. There's always something going to happen then after these things. He said, after these things, I saw a door open. After these things, this happened. And then we move into those chapters, which we will call Daniel's final seven. This period of the age, this period goes by numerous names in the Old and the New Testament. Anybody name some of those names it goes by? One would be the day of the Lord. He said, but the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night, which the heaven will pass away with a roar, and the elements will be destroyed with an intense heat, and the earth and its works will be burned up. Peter described the day of the Lord as a surprise when the world endures a great destructive force. But it ain't going to be a surprise to us, because we're going to know. He is going to put it in us just like he did those animals when Noah was trying to get them to the ark. They didn't get out there and play cowboys. I don't know if they called them cowboys back then. What would they have called them? Camel boys, Yahoo. I guess. That's where Yahoo came from. And then Paul described it this way in 1 Thessalonians, for you yourselves know full well that the day of the Lord will come just like a thief in the night. While they were saying peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them suddenly, like labor pains upon a woman when she's with child, and they will not escape. Daniel earlier told us about that, and Paul confirms it, that this is a dark day of destruction that's going to come upon the whole earth. And also, it's going to be a surprise to all of them. Because in Jeremiah it says, alas, for that great day is here, there is none like it, and it's a time of Jacob's distress, but who he will be saved from it? This is a time specifically intended for Israel, Jacob. Jeremiah says, and we remember from Daniel 9:24, if you remember in the notes, that this 7-year period was specifically part of a plan for Israel and Jerusalem. So the final period of the 7 years is the day of the Lord, and it's Israel's final accounting. And in the church, it will be known as one that nobody else will know. We will not be here because it is known as the tribulation, the great tribulation, and we aren't going to be here. But there's going to be those people from Israel that did not confess Jesus Christ. They will be here. That will be the time of reckoning that God is going to deal with them. But we've got to understand how the transition from the church age into Daniel's final 7 years of tribulation in chapters 4 and 5 provide the transition. They are a continuous scene, but we will take it by sections. We're not going to just rush right through it because I want to hear y'all's thoughts on it too. Because they divided them up into chapters and verses for our reading. And they even added some things for our ease of reading. But 4 and 5 should be one continuous chapter. So we just read, after these things, I looked and behold a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard, like the sound of a trumpet speaking with me, said, come up here. I will show you what must take place after these things. Immediately I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne was standing in heaven, and one sitting on the throne. And he who was sitting was like a jasper stone and a sardius in appearance, and there was a rainbow around the throne like an emerald in appearance. Around the throne were 24 thrones, and upon those thrones I saw 24 elders sitting clothed in white garments and golden crowns upon their head. That's a very amazing scene, and it details about the throne room if we go into it more, but we're not going to. But it begins with holy, holy, holy. They continually said that to God because he's only worthy of power and honor and glory. And followed by the fourth declaration of honor and glory at the end of chapter 5. And we'll get there because, like I said, that should be one continuous book. And John says that door in heaven opened, and he called to John to come up there. And we know it was Jesus calling because John says it was the same voice he heard earlier, one that sounded like a trumpet. And we know the scene was set after the church age had ended. We're not on this earth after that point. Jesus says he is showing John what must take place after these things, after the church is gone. And the details, the scene serves to show us that the age is ended. And the first thing that John sees is the Father God seated on the throne. He's called the Ancient of Days. I cannot wait to see our Father. We are created in his image. Did you know they say in the original scripts that they had that when God breathed into Adam and made him a living spirit, that you could set them side by side and the angels could look and they couldn't tell the difference between God and man before Adam fell because he was spirit. He was a spirit man and he looked just like his Father. And then when he fell, that all went away. And I just hate it because that happened, but there's nothing we can do about it except accept Jesus Christ and do our part now to try to save as many people and take dominion over things in this earth. We should not be letting the devil run the music industry. They shouldn't be running the school district. They shouldn't be running the government. But Christians have sat down on their butts. Yes, I said butts. And have done nothing. If you're qualified to do something in those areas, you need to do it for the kingdom of God. You need to take dominion and have authority over that because Jesus gave it to us. He said he did. And it's our fault because of sitting down and letting them. I remember when I was a kid, I used to say, nobody's going to have to come over here and kill us. I believe America will be destroyed from within. And look at it now. They've opened up the South gates and let all that in. And what's happening? All kinds of terrorists, people coming in. We will be destroyed from within our own government because we have let people that don't even believe in God be up there telling us how to live our lives. And there will come a day and time when they will say, you're going to do this or you're going to do that. And you're going to have a choice. Do you believe them and do it or do you serve God? You can't serve mammon and God. You're going to have to make your choice what you're going to do. And I hope that you get so sold out to Jesus Christ that there is nothing going to make you turn against him. Because God is on the throne. We're on the footstool. The earth is his footstool. And he is soon going to take over the whole tamale. But we're supposed to be doing something right now. We're not supposed to be sitting on our backsides. We're supposed to be working. And if you've got a job and you're working and you hate it, you're toiling. You're not supposed to be toiling. That is under the curse. You're supposed to work, but you're supposed to enjoy it and love every day of your life that you get up because you've got a purpose. Oh, I'm so glad I get to get up and do this again, 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 because you're doing what you were created to do. But if you're working hard and toiling, you're still under the curse. You're saved, but you're living under the curse. Get out from under it. Ask the Holy Spirit to lead you and to guide you. Shut your mouth and say, mind, shut up and listen to my spirit because my spirit is going to be directed by the Holy Spirit. And let God lead you where you need to be because life should be wonderful. We should be living it abundantly. All of us have trials and tribulations. Has anybody had a trial today?
A little bit.
My dog is sick.
I have.
She's had your dog sick. Everybody's had a trial.
I woke up to a flat tire.
You had a flat tire too?
Woke up to the tire to the rim.
That sounds like Charlie. He had a flat tire on several things, didn't he, Charlie?
I had
him. He's been under the tractor. He's been under the mower. He's been under this, under that.
I was just like, man.
That's just what you needed, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah.
Well, we're going to be in tribulation, but not the great tribulation. When they talk about that great tribulation, the day of the Lord, we're not going to be here, okay? God said, I have not appointed you under wrath. We will not be here. And when he showed us the vision about what was around the throne room, the stones, the colors, and I said we'd get back to that, but not in detail tonight. That is a vision similar to the same one Daniel saw when he saw the Ancient of Days in chapter 7 in Daniel. You can go back and look there. And elsewhere, John tells us in 1 John 4:12 that no one has seen the Father at any time. So like Daniel, we know John witnesses a vision prepared for him. It's a representation of the Father, not the Father's actual appearance, because he doesn't actually look like that. That is just a vision of what he saw. Because you've got to now, we are looking figuratively, we are looking symbolically, and we're looking at symbols. But we are going to be one of these days being before the Ancient of Days. And you can go before him in your spirit now. You can shut yourself off and ask, be by yourself, get your mind quiet, and let your spirit communicate with the Spirit of God. He said, I want those to worship me in spirit and in truth. And somehow the church has gotten to think that worshiping him in spirit and truth is speaking in tongues. But that's worshiping him in spirit and truth. He wants you to worship him because of the word of God and with your spirit being united with his spirit and you're calling upon him spirit to spirit. Just like deep draws to deep. I can meet somebody and they'll draw things out of me that I would have never thought would come out of me because deep draws to deep. Every one of you have met someone like that, haven't you?
Yep.
And that's the way it is with the Father. He wants us to have our spirit and his spirit to communicate one. And earlier we studied the letter to Sardis and we learned that the white garment represents the works of the saints. Revelation 19:8, it says, it was given to her to clothe herself in fine linen, bright and clean, for fine linen is the righteous acts of God. Get up every morning, look in the mirror and say, hello, good looking. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. That's who you are. You are that. And when God looks at you, he don't look and see Janice or Tammy or Joe Blow. He sees Jesus. When you've got Jesus Christ in you, he looks and he sees Jesus. And that's what justification is. When you make a screw up or you make a sin, he looks at you and that when you ask for forgiveness, he justifies it. It's just as if you never sinned. So that's why the devil can't beat you up. If he comes and says, well, you remember when you told that lie or you took that money or you did this or you did that? Shut up. I've been forgiven. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Know who you are. Can y'all say you're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus?
I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus.
It feels awkward when you first start saying it, but when you say it over and over and over, it comes out of your mouth just like, hello, honey. I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, and I am. And there is nothing. The devil can come at me, and he has been coming at me. Boy, he has, because I hate him, and he knows it. I don't care, because God is going to settle the matter. He's going to fight my battle. He's the Lord of Sabaoth. He is my warrior. He will take care of the battle. Because some battles I can't fight, only he can fight. And that's what I want y'all to know. You've got to learn to depend on him. Him and him alone. And then on those thrones, it indicates that he is ruling. And he knows that Jesus Christ, he was given a throne by God. He doesn't have a little bitty tiny throne. He's right there with God. And we're going to get to sit up there with God when we get to go there with him. So when you've got something to take away from here, remember Luke 22:28. You are those who have stood by me in my trials. That's what I want Jesus to say about us.
Can I say something?
Yes.
When you were saying, we need to say stuff like, I am the righteousness of God. So the other night I was reading in Jude, and Jude 1:24. Let me go to the King James part. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his holy glory with exceeding joy. I'm going to be presented faultless. So that's what how I look at myself. I'm not faultless, but yeah, I'm going to be presented faultless.
We're not faultless because we fall, but we are faultless because of Jesus Christ. And you put it under the blood, the blood, the blood, the blood, the blood. There's only two things that can cleanse you in the scriptures. I told you. What was it?
Blood of Jesus.
Water and blood. Water and blood. When they stuck that sword in Jesus' side, what came out of him?
Water.
Water and blood.
Mm-hmm.
Water and blood. And I thank God for that sacrifice that Jesus came to bring us back. He wants us to make our life Eden. He wants our place like Eden. He don't want us having problems all the time. He wants us to put the problems under our feet. Oh, how are you doing today, Joe? Well, I'm doing pretty good under the circumstances. Well, get out from under the circumstances. Get on top of them. Watch how you say things, you know?
Sometimes, okay, so like, I think one of the things that she might be talking about is like Romans 12:2, be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that sometimes we have to start here before we can physically make steps and changes. We first have to get our mind lined up to with what God recommends.
That's renewing your mind to the Word of God. You've got to have the mind of Christ. And miracles happen between the ears. You can go down to every preacher in town that's anointed and have his hands laid on you. But if you don't have a change of mind, you're not going to get healed. You're not going to get saved. You're not going to get anything. It all starts with the way a man thinketh, so is he. Remember that. He says, think on good things. Think on things that are good that'll build you up. If you read the Word of God, he'll tell you what you need to do. And if you do it, you will be blessed. Boy, will you be blessed. And this chapter, it shows about the vision of John, and it emphasizes the majesty of the sovereignty of God, and it focuses on the worshiping of God, his creative powers. I love it because he has creative powers. Do you know that, I don't know what's wrong with my computer, it just keeps blocking me off from y'all. Revelation 4 sets a foundation for the unfolding of the apocalyptic events that's going to be happening, and we will be talking about that as we continue in chapter 4. We're going to stop on the Bible teaching now, because I want anybody that's got anything to say it, because I want you to understand it, because I want you to grow up in Christ. I want you not to be babes that have to have milk. I want you to get a steak every now and then from God's Word. Give me a steak. Where's the beef? Where's the beef? y'all don't know that commercial. That was one long time ago.
I know
it's a British commercial, and this woman, she was with that man raised up to come. Where's the beef?
Let me ask you what you think. So in verse 7, when it says the first beast was like a lion, the second one was like a calf, and then the face of a man, and then a flying eagle. Do you think there could be any reasoning why he chose those to be part of his throne design? What do y'all suspect that why did he choose a penguin and a giraffe and a mountaintop? Why did he choose those?
Those were the local animals.
The man, the face of the man was a local animal?
Yeah. People around there.
Good thing you're a pilot.
All right, I've got that coming up in a teaching, because an ox is like a servant. It can carry heavy loads and burdens. An eagle can see and it can go. A man, he created man. That's his highest creation, is man. And then the other one was a lion. And what is Jesus? From the line of the tribe of Judah. I've got all those that I'll go into, Tammy, but that's why he chose those particular things, I believe. That's just my opinion now.
Well, let me tell you what I was thinking because of, I forgot what I was thinking.
Good thing you're not a pilot.
All the time. What were we talking about now? Hey, Sean and Gary, don't I do this all the time? It never stops.
Yes.
Okay, so we know that. Okay, I look like a crackhead, act like one. I'm not. Okay, so we know that stars are written in the heavens, that, you know, we can know God through his stars. So could his gospel be written out in his throne? So I was like, the God of heaven came as the Lion of Judah. God came as a man, no, as a sacrifice, the calf, for man, the face of man, so that we can fly like an eagle.
That's pretty good. Good analogy. Well, yeah. Everybody can be thinking about their analogy. That's a pretty good analogy. I had mine that I taught the teens, and that's what I'm going to bring up when we start talking about that and about the colors that are around the throne. They all have a certain significant meaning, every one of them, and you need to know what those meanings are.
Yeah, because you better hope for one, because I'm number two. I can tell you that much. Sapphire's number two.
Well, I'm emerald, okay? I'm the rainbow. I'm the cabinet girl.
Okay, I can tell you right now, Mom, you're emerald. You're number four. As far as the foundations under the new temple in Ezekiel 40 and on, it's got the listing of the birthstone colors and two emeralds four, so I don't know where y'all are at, but...
I'm talking about around the throne of God. I'm not talking about the temple. I'm talking about around the throne of God.
Well, it mentioned sapphire, so...
Yeah, it does. Emerald. There's jasper, which should have been a diamond, and then we've got the sardius, which is a red bloodstone, and then the emerald, which is a rainbow. So what are we going to do? Have an arm match about it, y'all? Okay, what's your birthstone, Gary?
Pardon me?
Your birthstone.
What's your birthstone?
I'm October. I think it's a diamond. It's either diamond or opal.
Opal's okay. Gem.
Diamond.
Oh, so you're diamond? Very good. Charlie?
Topaz, November.
That's right. He's topaz. Shauna?
Topaz.
Topaz. Shay?
It's March.
What color are you?
I thought it was amethyst, but that's not blue, is it?
No.
That's like
purple. Amethyst is February. Purple. I can't remember March's.
Yeah.
Well, they actually go from like middle of the month to the middle of the month. So part of October, because like part of August is also a Virgo, like September. So it's middle of the month to middle of the month.
So is amethyst purple?
Uh-huh. Yes.
Okay, so it's a blue. It's that light bluish color.
Is it
turquoise? Yeah. I just don't know the name of that.
I was trying to the tip of my tongue.
If y'all hadn't asked me, I could have told you.
What stone is March?
I can't. Okay.
Look, he's up there asking Siri. Hey, how old are you? You don't even know what color your birthstone is.
Aquamarine. There it is.
Yeah.
Aquamarine.
I knew that, Gary.
What's your birthstone?
Who?
The pastor.
Jimmy Luke, what is yours? Jimmy He's Luke? Muted. Well, unmute and tell us your birthstone.
I don't know what my birthstone is.
You're in September.
I've never cared enough to know.
I don't know.
It's like a blue color.
Well, if he's Virgo, then he's sapphire like me. If he's past that half of that month, he could be the next one over. I don't know how that falls, though.
21st, aren't you, Jimmy?
20th.
I always say it's 21st. And Kaylee, what are you?
She's helping the kid do something real quick, but October 19th. I don't know what that is either.
She's diamond.
Diamond. Mm-hmm. So we all got our stones. And Apple, what are you? You're wearing it on your finger. Or unless you put it somewhere, what's your birthstone?
Hold on. What are y'all saying? I'm sorry. Y'all are cutting out so bad.
What's your birthstone?
What's your birthstone? Oh, mine is peridot.
Dang. Ones topaz,
it's the ugly green one. I hate
I hate mine.
I hate my birthstone.
Yeah.
It's so ugly.
Peridot,
it's like Mountain Dew color.
You want to switch?
Look up and see what September was.
It's
it's sapphire. I'm September. I'm telling you. From the middle of the month to the middle of the month. So from like middle of September to the middle of October is another color.
September is a sapphire.
Yes.
Okay.
Born in September. Yeah.
I had two babies born in September. I had two born in February, and I had two born in July. And July, I think, is Ruby, isn't it?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay, that I kept saying that it was from middle of the month to the middle of the month, that was the astrology of, like, Libra and Virgo and all that kind of stuff. So, oops, I was doing that. Yeah. I do not dabble in astrology. I don't know.
No. There's a difference, Tammy, between astrology and astronomy, okay? And God tells the story of him in the stars. And I taught on that to the teens because in Job, God talked to him about that. There's a Mazaloth and the Mazaroth. There's just a difference in the spelling. And one is when you start dealing with astrology and we look at astronomy. And I'm into astronomy big time. I love to look at the stars. I love to see what things are going on. And Gary and my husband both are looking at starlinks being set off all the time. I love to go out there and see what's going on in the heavenlies because God said they were for signs and seasons and for us to see things. Well, are y'all ready to start doing some competition?